So there was a bit, there was a massive Dolce & Gabbana photo shoot in Portofino, Italy. And also I think there was a wedding. We have to talk about the Kardashian Dolce & Gabbana campaign, that also happened to be a wedding. The Kardashians shot a Dolce & Gabbana worldwide campaign in Italy. And also Kourtney Kardashian got married. It was such an amazing display of love between the two of them. I mean, it's crazy because I talked to Paul about it, because obviously if Paul and I wanted to get married on television, we would have that opportunity. And Paul said, for $10 million, I would not get married on television. He said, I would not make my wedding public for $10 million. I didn't even ask him about 20. I think he'd say no. He said, my life would change forever. And I, you know, when is enough enough? And it's funny because I was thinking about the fact that this wedding Dolce campaign extravaganza was beautiful. Everybody looked amazing and head to toe, even the kids. Like, would there be a breach of contract if like, is that why maybe Rob didn't come? Because he wasn't willing to wear Dolce & Gabbana, and like he would have broken the Kardashian contract starting with a K. The new contract should start with a K from now on. I think contracts should start with a K. But like every single, I think the Kardashian dogs were there wearing Dolce & Gabbana collars. I mean, it was a full-fledged Dolce & Gabbana, like literally Dolce & Gabbana jerked off all over the Kardashian wedding. But by the way, they looked so happy and it was amazing. And I think, I mean, I love that she did what she wanted. She wore what she wanted. That dress, you know, it was like a lingerie dress and with a veil of the Virgin Mary. That veil was gorgeous. Kris Jenner looked amazing. And like the picture with the veil that was like up on all those stairs was amazing. And there was a video somewhere of like Kendall, like trying to walk in flats up these crazy stairs in this dress. And I mean, it looks like they had a great time, and they are they're a family, you know. It was like a family dynamic. The song Sister Sledge was playing on a video, like We Are Family, I Got All My Sisters With Me, which was amazing. But I was talking to Paul about it, and he was saying, wow, like what, there are no limits. Like, when is enough enough? Like they can't stop. It's just more is more. Get every fucking nickel off that floor. We're not leaving a goddamn cent, not a cent in the joint. We are gonna fucking strip this place. This country will be stripped of every goddamn penny, nickel, you know, subway token, drachma, any currency that starts with a K is fucking coming into our bank accounts every which way but Sunday. Brands that trashed us a couple of years ago, owning them. Events that trashed us several years ago and wouldn't invite us, taking them over. It's a fucking smash and grab job, and we are taking no prisoners. It is called, it's the Kardashian country that starts with a K, and we're fucking running this motherfucker because they are not playing any games. It's the not fucking around crew. Get the fuck out of the way. And while you're getting the fuck out of the way, pay us to get the fuck out of the way. Also, like, I've gotten married on television. Like, I've experienced it. I've planned a wedding on television. There are cameras. It does make the experience different. It's not as intimate. It's strange for other people that are, you know, in attendance. It's definitely different. There's definitely a sacrifice. So I wonder, and it's not as intimate. Like, it is, but how do I explain it? It's like there's all this excitement that is about the actual event that's happening in your life, but it's layered and there's more excitement because there are cameras and an audience. And there's an audience in that room that's also aware that there are cameras. So it's like you're sort of in this weird world where there are cameras on you, but there's an audience beyond the cameras, the people that the cameras aren't really capturing because they don't really care about those other people that are at your wedding. So they're sort of like extras. They're extras. You're the stars in the movie. There are cameras and they're extras watching you be in this scene. And it's definitely different. And then you're also aware that there's an audience that's people watching television around the country and the world that are watching this, and the Kardashians have a bigger stage. And then there's an audience that are watching in the media. So there's no way that you're walking and eating an ice cream cone and you're not aware. You're not dumb. You've been doing this for 20 seasons, you're aware that that's something that you're in a role doing. The ice cream cone is a prop, you know, meaning like, you know, that that's like, grab the ice cream cone, roll film. Like, so can something be as intimate? Can something be, even if you've lived your whole life this way, like, are there any private moments, you know, like, are there moments that, because it's hard to be present. I've experienced it. I have a hard time being present, you know, going to an event with my fiance that just involves me taking some pictures. I feel self-conscious. If I bring Bryn to the iHeart Radio Awards and it's 20 minutes on a red carpet, I feel self-conscious that there are cameras and I'm being photographed. When I walk down the street, if there's someone who takes a picture and they want to take a picture of me and they less want to get a picture of her, let me get a picture alone, I feel self-conscious. There's no way that these dynamics don't happen in these grander schemes because they're so much bigger than what I've experienced. So I have, but I have some institutional knowledge, and it does take away from the actual emotion of the moment and the authenticity of the moment and the intimacy of the moment. It's an absolute fact that that moment is changed and that there's something about it that is for an audience. So that's interesting, you know, and that's something that Paul, my fiance, would never subscribe to. And I mean, never. So it's interesting. You have to be with someone who wants to roll with that program. Travis Barker wants to roll with that program. And Tristan Thompson and Kanye wanted to roll with that program. Like, you can't run that life and not want to roll with that hair and makeup produced filter program. A lot of you have asked me for my take on the Netflix series Bad Vegan. And not only did I watch Bad Vegan, but I had the bad vegan herself, Sarma Melngailis, on my podcast. She's been called the vegan Bernie Madoff, but is she? Sarma's coming on, and this was a controversial show. I happen to have been to the restaurant. I happen to know Jeffrey Chatterer. I happen to have met Sarma and her ex-husband. So when I saw this documentary, I was shocked because I knew some of the people, which had happened with the Tinder Swindler doc too. I had met that freak one time at a party and had his business card, the diamond guy or the so-called diamond guy. So sometimes I'll see something and say, wait a second, I know some of those people. I ate that lasagna. Wow. So I wanted to have her on because this involves so many elements, so many things in this recipe, so many things in this raw foods recipe, abuse, mental abuse, psychological abuse, swindling, stealing money, not paying people, like so many accusations, gambling, addiction, you know, cult-like tactics. I wanted to have Sarma on. I want to hear her take. There's so much to this that I really want to dig into this. And this is a very different interview than any interview that I've ever done. Years ago, so I lived in Chicago, and for about a year, I was raw. Long before it was popular, I was a natural food chef in, you know, before 9/11. So, and there was a woman named Karen, K-A-R-Y-N, that had a cafe, and she was raw, and she had studied with Ann Wigmore and about all the wheatgrass and all this, like, really what was really extreme, particularly in Chicago. So I've met Giuliano, the raw chef, and like a lot of those other alternative people through that world. And I've seen in New York all the different raw food cafes that were really, really edgy. So I was aware of Matthew even before you guys opened Pure and One Lucky Duck. He was doing something with Russell Simmons for his Jiva Mukti cafes. And we connected, and I had wheat, egg, and dairy free cookies. So I was baking them for him in conjunction with this cafe. And then he started to do something else. I don't remember what that was. But then I remember hearing about Pure Food and Wine and going, and the famous zucchini lasagna, and then going to see the place in Chelsea Market, One Lucky Duck, with those like spiced cashews and that stuff. And I met you there, not knowing any of this stuff, like, which hadn't happened yet. But I met you. I saw you were in the store. So, so I say this whole story for the listeners and for you because – A, I have no idea if you're aware of me, but I didn't know about any of this. I'm sort of in my own world in many cases. So I didn't know about any of this until people started saying, you need to see the show. I want to hear your comment on Bad Vegan. Still didn't even know that you were that person. Then someone right. who works with me said it too. Then like watched it, looked it up. I'm like, I know her. I know him. I know Jeffrey Chattero. I know all these people. Like, I know. So that was crazy. So that's like where I came into it from. And I watched the Netflix special and then had my opinion, which we'll get into, and then reached out to you. So I don't know what you know about all that, but that was like shocking to me.
I did listen to, I went and looked at your podcast and I saw a couple of them had mentioned Bad Vegan. So I went and listened to that. And then I had forgotten that you knew Matthew from way back, which was kind of reassuring to me because I think you said a few things that indicated that you kind of know things about him that a lot of people don't necessarily know. And right. so I kind of stepped into a situation with him that had some similarities to the one I then later stepped into with the, you know, the guy in the film.
So to let the viewers, to the listeners know, this guy, Matthew, a good looking, healthy chef, talk mm-hmm. of the town. I'm just, you know, I met him and I was going to bake my wheat, egg and dairy free cookies for him. I was running a natural food cafe. He was like all over the place. I remember him not like paying me or it not being what he said it was going to be. It didn't seem like he was a bad person. It seemed like he was all over the place and moving from one thing to the next and getting new partner to start a new exciting thing. And then a new partner to do this. And he's very charming and he meets a lot of different people and he's always on to another thing is what it seems like. And I think he's talented because I've seen him open these new restaurants and the vegan Mexican and the vegan Italian and all these places in New York. And then there's something in Miami, but then it's gone. And then there's something in New York. So he's done a good job of moving in a lot of circles. And I don't know where anything lands, but that was my perspective. And then seeing that you guys were together and then go into your cafe.
Yeah. Well, he and I got involved before either of us even knew what raw food was. And so I got involved in his restaurants and then also sort of taken down as they all closed. So that was a bummer for me, you know, that left me with some negative consequences that were ongoing financially, you know, after we split. So, and then, you know, and then we opened Pure Food and Wine together and then we split a year later. And then, yeah, from there on, I continued running it on my own.
Okay. So I watched Bad Vegan and I commented that it felt like you were in a one-person cult. And I watched with my fiance, and many people were very skeptical and thought you were part of it, et cetera. I didn't really think about that because it seemed very convoluted. Like, that would have been a really big, complicated trip to go on. I don't mean your road trip. I mean, like, right. to go on, to be involved. It seems like...
Well, and for what benefit?
Yeah, it seems like you just got, like, immersed and enveloped in this thing and it went deeper and deeper. And it does feel like a Ponzi scheme in the sense that you were deeper and deeper. And I'm sure you knew something was wrong, but I don't think you knew exactly what was wrong. And I don't think you knew how to get out. And I think that it might also have had something to do with your previous relationship. So I really need to hear from you what went down, like about that. There's the relationship and getting in so deep when you see the numbers. So what went down?
Well, I think I heard you say that in another podcast as well, and that is entirely correct, the cult of one dynamic, because, you know, on the other side of this, people who've been in cults and gotten out, those are like my people. We understand each other. And there are so many similarities between this guy and other cult leaders. So, you know, those people have a lot of similarities, and then the tactics that they use to pull people in are pretty much almost the same. So when a lot of my healing involved hearing the stories of people who'd been in cults. I'm friends with Sarah Edmondson from Nexium. So that whole situation with mm-hmm. Q3 and Area, I've paid a lot of attention to that. And the people coming out of it, talking about, you know, the realizations they've had, because what happens is on the other side of it, everybody's going, I don't understand. how could you not see it? How come you didn't run? How come? And there, and what happened, and the same thing happens to people who are in cults because it seems insane and people don't understand how come you didn't run? How come you didn't call the police? And the problem is that on the other side of it, we all have the very same questions. Like, I, you know, we come out of it having the same questions. Like, I don't, wait, why didn't I run? You know, and what happens is, which I think that it would help if more people understood this so they could hopefully avoid it. But, you know, is the extent to which your mind gets manipulated, I think, is underestimated. And then in particular, there's assumption that if you're a smart, intelligent person, you couldn't be manipulated. And people say that all the time. They say, oh, well, that would never happen to me. Or they say that or think that. But it could. I mean, there's certainly certain personality types that are far more susceptible. And I'm definitely one of those, but intelligence has absolutely nothing to do with it. And in fact, like, you know, successful people, I mean, this has happened to a ton of women who've been successful and have built something and created something and then have it, you know, taken down and in this sort of fiery crash. And in my case, in a way that made it look like I had done it. So, yeah, I mean, not only was everything destroyed and I felt horrifically awful about it and, you know, all these people were hurt and everything I'd spent all these years building and creating was gone, but all these people I cared for were hurt. And then layer on top of that, that it was made to look like it was my fault or intentional in some way, which doesn't really make sense to me, but I can understand, you know, people being angry at me for not having seen what was going on, or I mean, I can understand that part of it, but thinking that there was some malice on my part doesn't really make any sense whatsoever with the facts of the situation. And I think that, you know, I've been very public about the way the film was presented. And I wrote a lot of stuff on my website, clarifying all these questions that people had and the things that were portrayed incorrectly. So I kind of wrote all this stuff, put it out there, it's there. And I've been pleased that at least some people, they have gone and, you know, I've gotten a lot of messages from people who say, I watched it, I was confused at the end. You know, I'm really glad I found your website and read what happened, and now I understand better. So, yeah, and now I'm still kind of trying to come out there and talk about it in a way that's helpful for people.
Okay, so I want to break down a few things. First of all, I'm not a gotcha person. I'm not, like, bringing people on here. I've been on shows where someone tries to, like, catch me in something, and I'm not doing that. But I'm not going to just, you know, I'm speaking for people and myself, and I want to, like, break this down because there are always multiple sides, and I'm sure you're going to take some responsibility for this because you're not just a victim of something that happened. You definitely participated in some way, I imagine. I don't mean like ripping people off per se. I just mean we all have to accept some level of responsibility for the situations that we're in, I think, and you may correct me. So as far as the dynamic with the person, when you say it could happen to anybody, do you feel there's an element where you get together in the beginning and it feels great and you feel loved or you feel connected, and then you're constantly chasing the dragon to get back to that? Like, that's how it keeps going. First, it's amazing and you fall for that, and then something isn't great, but then something great happens and you keep going back, and then you get deeper and deeper. Like, what about that element of just people who get sucked into someone else's vortex? It has happened to me. It wasn't necessarily someone who was abusing me by any means, or it wasn't someone who abused me, but it was something where there was no reason I would stay in this situation, and I kept staying in it because I kept thinking like I was imagining it or that it would get better because I was going back to some stuff from the beginning. And also what was going on in my own life was I was feeling alone, and it was the only thing that I really had going. And sometimes as you're older, you don't really want to go look for something or be alone. And so it's the most familiar thing to you. So I want to talk about that aspect of just the interpersonal getting, like, staying with something that is obviously unhealthy, forgetting cult or anything like that, just that dynamic.
Yeah, I mean, it's all related. In my case, I think it's very, very common that there's this period of time that people call love bombing in what's being termed narcissistic abuse type relationships. And that wasn't really the case in my situation. You know, it was a bit more complicated than that, but whatever, you know, what happened happened so gradually over a long period of time. And what's shocking to me, when I've gone back and read the correspondence that I was able to retrieve, which is only some of it, not all of it. And he had tried to delete everything. So he, you know, he tried to like wipe out all the, you know, evidence of everything, which is pretty telling. And I'm trying to recover it all.
Yeah.
But looking back at it and reading all of it was, you know, it's me trying to figure out what's happening. And what was shocking is how many times, I mean, I did remember this, the number of times in the beginning that I tried to push him out and get rid of him. And then one way or another, he would kind of get back in. And
charming? By charming you in some way?
It was less charming and more like sometimes circumstantial. And then also, I don't remember exactly the timing of it, but once he got me to give him money, you know, claiming of like some kind of insane emergency and he needed it right away. And so if you're kind of a kind, generous person and you're not by nature suspicious, you know, so I was able to give him some money, but then that was like the hook that, because there were times in the future where he would say, well, I'm going to bring you money. I'm going to pay you back. I'm going to bring you money. And then I'd be like, oh, okay. And so he'd come, you know, see me over the weekend and maybe he'd bring me some money, but not what he said it was. And it wasn't, you know, even half of what I had loaned him. And, but then he'd be in front of me. And for some reason, whenever I was in his presence, it was a lot harder to, it was as if he had more power when he was in front of me in ways that I don't, you know, that I still don't quite fully understand. So the
hook being, you said circumstantial, that makes some sense. If you disconnect from him, you're not going to get the rest of the money. And when you say circumstantial, did he often say it seemed like he was going to solve certain problems for you? I'll handle this for you. And you sort of like had these false hopes of these different things that he was promising you. So that was another hook. Is that accurate or no?
Yeah. And I think that I heard described something that made so much sense to me and sort of answered, you know, an open question that I had was a guy named Mark Vicente, who was in the Nexium cult. And he's in that that documentary, the HBO, The Vow. And they in a podcast with Sarah and Nippy, who are also in it, they were talking about, you know, because that guy Keith Raniere is really goofy and people look at him and think, how could everybody have sort of, you know, worshipped him as if he was some kind of a god? And how could they believe that, you know, these outlandish claims he made about himself being, you know, the smartest person in the world and all these ridiculous claims looking back? And something that Mark said that made so much sense to me was, and I'm completely paraphrasing and I probably should have, I wrote it all down somewhere, but that it's, what they do is they find a way of presenting you with like your idealized self. So all your kind of hopes and dreams and who you really want to be. And in my case, it was, I wanted to be independent and able to grow my business and, you know, and do good things and build this brand and be independent and free. And that's kind of what he, not necessarily directly, but that's kind of what he got me attached to, was as if he could enable me, he could get me there, or he could deliver that. And things were never stated explicitly. So it was always kind of very vague, but it's like, that's what I got attached to. Cause I never understood. People would say to me like, well, you know, the things you do for love. And I was like, that's not right. It's not like, I might've in some way felt like I loved him, especially early on, but you know, even in the beginning, from what I read in our correspondence and what I remember, I mean, I was afraid of him. I didn't, you know, even the first time he saw me after that, the first time I saw him in person after that, I was like, oh yeah, I probably shouldn't, you know, he's not really what I thought he's going to be. I shouldn't see him again. So it wasn't like this love attachment. And I think what happened was, you know, what people like him are extremely good at, which is dangerous, is reading people and very, very quickly understanding precisely what are your buttons, what are your weaknesses, what are your hopes and dreams, what can he, you know, he would know exactly what types of things to say in, you know, subtly that would get me unconsciously attached or hooked.
Well, so that's because that's what they do. So I guess if we're not realizing that someone, it's much easier to be scammed. I mean, if a person, if they are the scammer and that's what they do and you have no idea it's coming, you're just wide open as a human being. And that's why many of us get less trusting. But it's funny that you brought up the guy from Nexium too, Keith, because I call it with women in non-cult leaders. I mean, I call them trick guys, men who seem, they're not that good looking. They're not like that big stud. And so you think they're going to be safe because what the hell, you know, they can't get anyone. They're going to be loyal to you. They're not that attractive. They're sort of dorky. So, but they can be very dangerous because they probably have a lot of insecurities from not being the best looking person, the best looking man. And, you know, now they have something to prove in life.
Yeah. I think that, all of what you said is correct. I've always been much better at, if somebody's coming at me, my instinct is not, you know, I'm not good with boundaries. I have not historically been good with boundaries. Conflict. If somebody mistreated, well, I avoid conflict, but just not good at kind of not good at protecting myself. But if somebody, and this happened a number of times, if somebody mistreated one of my employees or Leon, my dog, it's like I would turn into a roaring lion. Like I have yelled at people and, you know, demanded that, you know, how dare you speak to her like that? Get out, you know, get the fuck out of here or whatever. I've screamed at people in the restaurant to get the fuck out. And like, how dare you, you know, say that to one of my hosts. And so on behalf of somebody else, I can turn into, you know, like this mama bear defender. But
what about your mother when what about your mother when, so I saw in the documentary that he was this, what's his name again? The man, sorry.
Well, his real name is Anthony Strangis. And in my book, so I'm almost done with the book, but I call him Mr. Fox.
So Mr. Fox, you did not find out until the very end that he was taking money from your mother?
I think, yeah. So I was in the Tennessee jail talking to my sister, when I found out, you know, how much he had taken from my mom. So I think, to be completely forthright, I think I knew that he was kind of getting money. Like sometimes he would, have me send money to her and then she would give it to him. And so I knew at times that she had given him money and then, you know, I thought he gave it back to her or, you know, and I think I knew that he must have taken some from her, but you know, when I heard the amount, it was like, it was just one of those many moments that I had where I just, you know, fantasized a meteor hitting the earth exactly where I was at that moment. Cause I just wanted to like, you know, curl up and die.
Because I would say that's the line. If you had any idea that he was manipulating your mother, that I would think you would kill him. Like I would think you would grab him by the jugular, like go for the jugular. How much did he take from your mom and how much from you? What's the grand tally?
I believe from my mother, he got over roughly 450 grand, which, you know, she didn't have. My mom's, and she, you know, runs a business. So that put her in a really compromised position, which has been among the worst parts of this, the aftermath. You know, it's one thing if he only took from me and I was the only one that was harmed, but all the other people being harmed is what's most difficult to deal with. And then for me, I don't know that I ever did like a precise total because it's also a lot of it was in cash and not a lot, but some of it. But anyway, I think it was, you know, it was over $2 million that he got from me. Yeah. And part of what made me feel held back when he came and found me was, you know, that after my relationship with Matthew, I was in a lot of debt from that. And I carried that and it was a big weight and it was, you know, and then I had, effectively bought the restaurant from Jeffrey Chartero for a note. So I owed that money. So I just felt sort of I had been saddled with debt. And it's something hit me the other day where I realized that it's been 20 years that I've been a human being with like unwieldy, unmanageable, large amounts of debt on my head. It's been 20 years. And I feel
that's
like
that's a lot of, yeah. What is it now? What is the debt now?
I think I said at the end of the film, and then people acted like I didn't care because I laughed, but I laughed because when I sat down and did a rough total with a friend of mine, the number that I came to was so large that it just seemed like, you know what I mean? It was like, it made me laugh in a like, holy shit kind of a way.
Right.
But it's, you know, between 4 and 6 million.
Okay.
Probably closer to 4, but you know, again, I don't necessarily know because there's, you know, in some places that, you know, who knows interest and penalties. And then there are some people, you know, I've heard from some people who said like, you know, oh, I've written it off. Don't worry. But so I don't know the exact total, but it's something that I have to, I will, you know, I sort of fantasize about the day that it's completely paid and done.
I get it. So the employee, there's a lot to go through. So that's why I'm like, I want to make sure to try to get to a lot of it. Many people listening may not even realize that you were in a relationship with a man who just kept, like the Tinder swindler times 10, kept asking for more and more money, and you got deeper and deeper. So I just want people to like sort of, a lot of people know the story, but maybe a lot don't. So what about the employees? Now that's a big hot ticket item. The employees who you seem to have a great relationship with, they were skeptical of this relationship with this Mr. Fox. And then you owed them. What did you owe the employees when you ran and they were all picketing outside the restaurant? Like, what's the actual number in totality?
So here's where, you know.
And we'll get into the whole Netflix thing too. You could talk about it now, but I'm saying we're going to get into everything and the inaccuracies if there are.
Well, right. And so among them is like, I didn't run. And also they were paid. And then he took me away and then they were not paid and therefore owed money. So it's not like I didn't pay them and then ran.
Okay. So what do you mean? What does that mean?
Took me away.
But what does that mean? He took you away. You went away. I'm saying like, you're saying like in the cult mentality, you just were brainwashed and went, like you did go away from your, this is now getting interesting because the cult, people go there and live there and they're living that world. And in many cases they're farming and having sex with each other. And like, it's one like world. You still have a business that you're running with people that aren't in this cult. And so like, you are like still living in the world of having your own apartment. So now you're like leaving the people that work for you that you're paying in a transactional business way and going off, he took you. So that's where it gets strange and different. So I want to really understand what that part means because you're leaving people. But then what do you mean? What would the movie shows that they're picketing while you're gone or something. So can you explain what happened financially with these employees?
Well, you know, I only found out after the fact, but
what does that mean?
Meaning like when I was arrested in Tennessee, when I first spoke to somebody, anybody, my sister, whoever it was that I first spoke to from there, she could have told me that the restaurant was still open because somebody had kind of stepped in and taken over and it was still running for all I knew. And so the entire,
I literally don't understand who would have, isn't it your restaurant?
Yes, but I mean, theoretically, somebody, I don't know. Again, it's hard to explain. It's like somebody taking me and putting me in a quasi coma for 9 months.
Right, you know? But you can't say someone could have cut, like no one can come in here and do this podcast for me today because I've like decided to go somewhere, even if I'm in a coma. I'm just saying like that thought of someone could come in, like it is your restaurant that you owe Jeffrey Chatero money for. And I'm not grilling, I swear
right,
I'm not.
But maybe he could have, you know, theoretically, I suppose, I mean, in terms of like who would have had the legal authority, you know, he probably had the legal authority to come in or somebody, I don't know.
No, but there's no conversation. Like someone could have the legal authority to come in, but like there needs to be a conversation. It's a restaurant with like raw food recipes. Like someone can't just show up and start making zucchini lasagna with dehydrated, you know, and cashew like cheese. Like it's
well,
like,
no, I mean,
So what was the conversation when you're leaving? Like, isn't it like, I'm leaving my raw food restaurant. So Jeffrey, so, like, you just walked out of there and like the employees can't run a restaurant. My employees can't run my business.
Oh, mine could have. They could have. This is where, you know, part of the reason why I feel so close to people who've been in cults is because, you know, when I say things that might sound kind of crazy or hard to understand to other people, the sort of former cult people get it. So when he told me that, like, to think of it as if time stopped and we were just sort of like, you know, we had to step away. We had to walk away and like be in this altered, like,
universe.
Basically. Yeah. So it was like, as if it wasn't real in a way. And that sounds bonkers, but you know, there was a moment, a guy that I know who was in the Moonies and has since become a psychologist and gone on to write really helpful books about cult psychology, and talking about his experience on the Leah Remini's show, he said at one point, he said, if they had told me to kill somebody, I would have. And, I wouldn't have killed somebody. I'm pretty sure I could say that. I wouldn't have killed somebody. But I understood that was painful to hear, painful, but also it's so tragic. It was tragic to hear because I understood that. I understood how it could get to that point.
Wow.
And so his taking me away and telling me that basically it's to think of it as if time, like as if the rest of the world time stopped and we were like slipping into an alternate, like, you know, some sort of parallel universe. You know, I think I just, you know, I don't know. It's as if like I was some sort of subdued animal that just became, you know, somebody who he could do this to. And, you know, when I talk about that time away, sort of in shorthand, I just, you know, it's like I refer to it as like the road trip from hell, because, it's been sort of painful for it to be depicted in, you know, originally in the sort of tabloidy media and whatnot, as if like we ran off and, you know, we're staying like in nice hotels, like,
right.
Yeah. And like living the high life and being, and the reality was so wildly, wildly different from that. The reality was more like those videos that he had taken of me.
Well, that's okay. So I have a couple of questions about that. So now you're away. So can you just tell me the number with the employees and where the money went and where that is now and what they all feel about it and what they all think about this whole thing that they've been through?
Well, it was my impression, and I thought that I was told that the end of the film was going to state that they'd all been paid, because okay. They were paid in, or the amount that they were owed was paid in 2020.
By you?
Yes. So normally, you know, one doesn't, the thing about documentaries, which I think there needs to be like a new category, because I say that Bad Vegans like should not be called a documentary, but normally people don't get paid. So on the one hand, you know, people were assuming that I must have been paid millions of dollars. I was not, but okay. I was given an amount that covered what the employees were owed. And so, you know, when that sort of went through, because I agreed to participate, but I wanted that amount that they were owed to get paid.
Is that why you did it?
I wanted it to be something that would be useful and helpful. And so mm-hmm. I wanted to tell the story. But I also wanted my employees paid. So I worked that out as part of the deal. Were paid in March of 2020, and it like just so happened that the wire situation went through the day that New York City restaurants were shut down because of the pandemic. So I felt like that was a good day for a lot of them who were probably still in the restaurant business to get kind of word that, like, you know, the money's there, they can, whatever they were owed.
And what have they said? Where are they with it now? Do you talk to any of them? Like, is it clean?
I do. I talk to a lot of them.
Okay.
I mean, with all of the ones that I talked to, in particular, the ones who were there for a long time, who knew me really well. And I think they knew, you know, they knew me really well, as did a lot of customers and sort of followers, knew me well enough to know that that business was my whole life. You know, that brand was like my mm-hmm. identity.
It was very good.
They knew that, like, they knew that something terrible happened, not that I would have destroyed it, because that didn't make any sense. And it was a valuable brand and we had so many opportunities. So the idea that I would have willingly destroyed it made no sense.
Right.
So even if they didn't, you know, even if they didn't understand what had happened, they knew that like something terrible happened. And that was the
something drastic had to happen.
And so it was painful to see, like really painful to see those picketing images, but I understood. To me, I kind of almost thought of it as like, as if, because I had an almost maternal relationship with all of them in some ways, I felt very protective of them. And so it was as if like mom, you know, got this boyfriend that she then went off the deep end with and abandoned them. And so, of course they were angry, but you know, some of the people in those photos, you know, it happened, I think a couple of times that I ran into people just on the street in New York, and it was like we immediately fall into a hug and I start crying.
Wow. So what about, where is he now? What happened? Did he respond? Did he try to sue? What is he? Where did that guy go and what happened to him?
There is an article written about where he is now, which he's in somewhere outside of LA, apparently, which is, you know, good for me that he's on another coast.
Right.
And I had followed, I used to look periodically every few weeks before on Twitter, just to kind of, you know, because when somebody like that is out there, you would rather keep tabs on him, which is kind of part of the reason why I was in touch with him in the first place. It's like, you'd rather know where they are than worry that they're going to, you know, so I would kind of periodically look at his Twitter, and I did see, and then he got booted off of Twitter. I don't know why, but I can imagine he said something, whatever. But before that, I saw from some of the pictures and what, like I knew he had gone to LA.
But as a functioning individual, like as what name, as a,
he'll never be a functioning individual.
No, I mean, as pretending he's, I'm just saying he's not been arrested. It's like the Tinder swindler. He's just living his life and no problem.
Well, we were both arrested in Tennessee.
Oh, right. That's right.
And then what happened was I got out on bail. He didn't. So he stayed at Rikers for a year. Okay. And then I got out on bail, you know, fought my case, which was kind of pointless. And, you know, I wasn't going to go to trial because I didn't have the stomach or the funds for that. So I did what a lot of people do and just, you know, take the plea. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, the sort of sickening thing was that I had to go serve my months at Rikers. I call it my summer on the island, after he was released. So I was locked up while he was out free. You know, now he's out free, clean slate, and I had
clean,
to go.
What does that mean, clean slate? He still has a
clean slate for him because he's not saddled with the debt. Even though technically, I think we're jointly responsible for like roughly $850,000. But you know, he's one of those people that he's never going to pay a dime, and he doesn't give a shit. So I will, because I give a shit, and I'll figure out a way to, you know, I'll figure out some way down the, you know, to make that happen. So,
wow. And it's your opinion that the money's gone, that it's gambled, that he's a gambler, and you didn't even realize what a gambler he was.
Right. And he didn't act like, I don't think he's a typical gambling addict. I think he's like more of the sociopathic variety where they kind of don't really care. They like the risk and the stimulation, and so it makes sense that he gambled, but not in a way that, it's different than a typical, like when a normal person has a gambling addiction, it's like this tragic, it's very tragic because it's, you know, because they're destroying their lives and they're like losing money and they feel guilt and shame and la la la. He didn't, none of that applies.
Because it's not his own money. Maybe there's a difference in the emotional way you feel when it's not your own money and it's just, you're playing with the house's money. You're literally taking other people's money.
Somebody like him. For me, if I was like investing money on behalf of other people and I lost it, I'd feel worse than I would.
Oh, no, 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 no. I'm saying for someone who's stealing. Right. Okay. That's an interesting different dynamic too.
Well, for somebody who doesn't have a conscience, you know, it's just sort of like life is a game and destroying and controlling people is fun. And, you know, and that's sort of the point, because people also have asked me a lot, you know, we were in this really strange town in Tennessee, and people are like, well, what were you doing there? And I'm like, I don't know. Well, what was the plan? If you hadn't been arrested, like, what was the plan? I'm like, I don't know. I have no idea. You know, I didn't know if he had any money in the end. I didn't know if he ran out of money. I didn't know if he, maybe he got us arrested intentionally, which is, I know sounds weird, but I think that might've been the case. So there's a lot of unanswered questions, but they make more sense in the context of him being the type of person that he is without a conscience. And so for him,
were you ever in love with him?
I don't think so. I think that I maybe thought that I was, or it was more, it wasn't love. It was like this sort of sickening attachment,
but kind of like still, what I described before. Do you ever feel anything towards him in your mind? Like, because it's in your body and having nothing to do with logic, like you were, like if you were in a cult, I wonder if you still, do you still, like if you saw him, would he have the potential to make you feel weak again in some way, do you think? Does he have that hold on you in some weird, sick way?
I would be afraid to see him, but I would feel like now, I mean, I would feel strong enough that I don't, you know, I'm aware that, you know, he has this intense way of looking. I'm aware that he could say anything in, you know, he could say all kinds of things. And, you know, I wouldn't believe him unless he like sprouted wings and, you know, floated up in the air and turned into a, you know, shape-shifted into some other, like, basically I wouldn't believe anything.
Even though you probably didn't before too, though. It's different. Like, you don't believe them, but your body's believing them. Like, you don't believe them, but you're still going in that direction. What's your relationship like with your parents now?
It's fine. It's good. I mean, my parents are both, you know, they're very kind of down to earth, non-judgmental people. And it's not strained with my mother, but I feel it's upsetting that I sort of feel kind of queasy around her, not around her because of her, but because of the guilt that I feel like all of that was my fault. And so the extent to which she's, you know, still working and not retired, or,
oh God,
you know, I feel like that's my fault.
So there's an underlying tension, an underlying self-consciousness.
Yeah. And we even, just the other day it came up that there was something she wanted to ask me about. So we agreed we'd talk about it, but we haven't talked about all of it in as much detail as one would think. I think in part because we both find it kind of nauseating, and like, you know what I mean? It's like, you don't really want to go there. So there's even things where in writing my book, I'm sort of like, well, I wonder, you know, I have questions that I want to ask her, but then I don't want to put her in the position of having to go back there and remember. So I'm just like, well, I just won't get the answer to that question. You know what I mean? That's
no,
difficult.
I do. I'm just, my gut is saying to me, that's an interesting dynamic in your household, that it's sort of like, let's just brush it under the rug and act like it didn't happen, where it could be healing, but also maybe there's something to that dynamic that gravitated both of you towards this type of person that you both, I don't want to say fell for, because you both got brainwashed, but there's a certain personality type I'm sure people target. And I just think it's interesting. Mm-hmm. Maybe you both should probably address it and start being the active participants versus the people that things happen to. I'm not a shrink. That's the first thing that came to mind. Like, you should just, you fucked up and you put her in a position and you were brainwashed and then she was brainwashed. It's a shitty situation. You feel guilty. You might as well just bring it out, not on Thanksgiving dinner, but I feel like you should probably just like lay it out.
I mean, it's not like we don't talk about it at all, but it's just that, you know,
like, money's not that, everything, but this toxin could probably, is worse than losing money, I would say. So that's just my unsolicited opinion. You could throw it in the garbage.
Yeah. And things with my father are also fine. He insisted on visiting me a lot when I was at Rikers, which I kept telling him he didn't need to do, because it's not like you just show up and, hey, I'm here, and visit somebody. Right. It's like a huge, huge ordeal. And he's 83 now.
Wow.
He's in really good shape. But he came, I think he came like four times.
Wow.
To see me, which he insisted on doing. So.
And what was that experience like? Being in jail.
I mean, it was. My book doesn't even go there. I'll have to write another because I don't have time to get into that. But it was its own incredibly interesting experience that on the other side of it, I feel like I'm really grateful for being exposed to things that fall into that category of things that make you a more compassionate person.
Were you terrified and was it not as bad as you thought? Like, were you terrified and was it a learning experience? Not just that you don't want to go back there, but just, was there anything positive about being in prison?
I think positive it was an amount of time that was, it was a bummer, but it wasn't like years. So it's not, you know, I know there's a lot of people that are falsely accused and convicted and go away for sometimes life or even 5 years, 10 years. That's all hideously awful. So, you know, a summer effectively is not the end of the world. But it still sucks. And yeah. It still sucks. It's still scary. I think in the film, the director asked my father if he was worried about me going to Rikers. And my father said, no, I knew she could handle herself, which made me, some people thought that would upset me, but it actually made me feel good that he like had confidence that I would be able to handle myself. And I did. And towards, you know, the longer I was there, the more comfortable I got. So
how long was it?
Well, the sentence was 4 months, but I'd already served roughly 2 weeks or 20 days when I was first arrested before I was out on bail. So when I went back to do the remainder of the 4 months, it was like 3.5 months.
That's still, that's some time.
And yeah, it was the summer of 2017. So I served.
That was your camp. You know,
some people summer at the Hamptons. I summered at Rikers.
You summered at Rikers. Interesting. That's crazy. Wow. Yeah,
I mean, there's a lot of, crazy stuff happens there. And there's a lot of stuff to see just about humanity in general. But yeah, I mean, it's something I could write a separate book about, just that part of it.
Yeah. Did you keep in touch with anybody from prison? Did you meet any interesting people there? Like, did you learn something? Were they hard on you or was it just a crappy lodging experience with some discipline?
I learned a lot. Even now, I think I have, you know, I haven't flown in a long time since before COVID. And so I was going through the security line and the way that they were sort of particularly grumpy TSA, you know, sometimes they're like happy and cheery and sometimes they're really grumpy and you're like afraid to like, oh my God, I'm supposed to take my laptop out and I didn't and they're going to yell at me. And then you have to take your shoes off and you have to walk through the security thing. And all of it, all of a sudden, and kind of the way they're dressed, all of a sudden I was like reminding me of being in jail. And I got through security and like burst into tears. And I was like, whoa, I guess that still affects me in some way. Huh. That I was not expecting. So there's something inherently sort of traumatic about being locked up. But also there were things about it that, I mean, I read 50 plus books. I got a bajillion letters from people that were incredibly kind and lovely. I got tons of letters. People mailed me loads of books. And the longer I was there, the more confident I got in terms of, I just handled myself in a way that was very not, I was able to like avoid any confrontation. So if somebody tried to engage me and get in a fight or start something, I was just like, you couldn't, it was like trying to fight a noodle. Like I wouldn't, I just wouldn't react. Mm-hmm. And I think the people that I was in the dorm, cause I was in a dorm with 50 other women and a lot of that, the population in there is constantly rotating. Mm-hmm. So there are always new people coming in, but the people that were there the longest, and the ones who sort of like ruled, you know, there's always like these like group dynamics is always like the ones that are in charge that everybody's afraid of. I had a good relationship with them. And so nobody really messed with me.
Wow. Okay. Well, that's nice and lucky and a good story because it's all the movies for us. I think It happened. It's really a big it happened. Like, you have a reason to feel guilty. You have a reason to self-loathe. You have a reason to be self-conscious. You have a reason for all these things you've just said. But you need to fucking put that away now into a box. You could write a letter to all the 10 people, to Jeffrey Chad or everybody, and you need to seal that up with a key, and you need to go to work and make money and start paying these people back. Like, I understand you're upset, and you should be, but like, if we think about what's going wrong, if I think about all the things that are going wrong, I can't do it. Like, and I'm pretty successful and I make a lot of money and I go. So you have to like, just cause you gotta like become a little bit cold now. And it happened. I'm sorry to everybody. I'm sorry, Mom. I'm sorry. And now you have to pull yourself up from your bootstraps and start really making money, because then this can have a happy ending. Like, this can ending.
Yeah. I mean, I think so too. I actually believe that. And I think, you know, it's not like I'm sitting here alone eating bonbons and crying all day at all. So, and I think that, you know, what you said about putting it in a box, some people have said, you know, why would you put yourself writing through the book? That must be so hard. And for me, I feel like that has been a necessary process.
Yes.
To go through it, you know, put myself through having to read all this stuff, having to be really honest and, you know, writing the story, writing my feelings, writing as much as I can figure out and be insightful about how it happened. Hopefully when other people read it, it will help them avoid stepping into the same thing. So once I'm done writing that, it's like, then I feel like that's done. And now I can move on from sort of trying to look at it and analyze it. And that will be a big relief when that's done. And I can kind of focus exclusively on other things. And I am focusing on other things. And I have, you know, some things that are in the works that will hopefully, you know, help me, enable me to be able to go on and do some useful, productive things.
Yeah, like document, I'm going to make $4 million. This is it. I'm starting my journey right now. I'm going to make $4 million. And this is what I'm going to do. I'm bartending. I'm an assistant. I'm dancing by the airport. Whatever you decide, you go and you're like, and then you show everybody. I made a mistake. I'm going to pay my mother back. I'm going to pay Jeffrey back, and I'm going for it. I feel like it would be like, you survived Rikers. So like, you don't think about the debt. Don't think about the past. I can make $4 million. So you can make $4 million. So I've been very unsolicited in my opinions, and I don't believe in them. So you can throw it all away. I don't know why this just, because I know all the people and because I saw it, and I don't know. And it just provoked me. So I wanted to sort of talk to you, and like my fans were very invested in this too. So I feel like I'm trying to, you know, get for them too, not just to talk to you about.
Yeah. And I think there's a, you know, going forward, there's a, you know, I think there will always be a balance of, I think I'll always talk about it to the extent that I feel like it's useful. And in particular, because, you know, a lot of the sort of vitriol that's come at me and people, you know, yelling at me that it's my fault and I'm a criminal. And this, I've heard from so many, mostly women, but some men, but mostly women, who will write me private messages that are absolutely heartbreaking. And I feel like because what's happened to me is very public and I have a platform, that I feel responsible. Like, I feel like I want to speak out for them because they don't have a platform. They can't talk about it. And they always said, you know, what I hear over and over and over again is, you know, watching your story, now I feel less alone. Or, you know,
and I get that, but that's
what happened to me, like, nobody under.
I get that. That's 50% of the equation. It's jumping off the page for me, the $4 to $6 million, your mom. It's just jumping off the page. I get that. You're helping other people. You're paying for it. That's a touching story, and it is. And there are other people saying that story too in the world, the people, the victims of the Tinder swindler, and the documentary showed it too. I think it should be doing that and check that box and figuring out a way to pay the people. Like, I owe nobody anything, and that would suffocate me, and that should be your main focus. Not just helping other people that it could happen, but that should be the main focus. Like, I'm so unsolicited. I totally apologize. And I'm not coming. I'm really not. I'm just passionate about this. I don't know why.
Do you know, that reminds me of, because I mean, yeah, it is absolutely suffocating. And so, you know, getting out from under that is my main, is my main priority. But I did, I think you asked me in the beginning, you know, what I know, and I've never watched Real Housewives because I can't, like, people fighting makes me upset. I can't watch stuff like that. But I did years ago when Bethenny was on, and I don't watch a lot of TV, but I got like sucked in and I watched all of that. And I'll never forget one part when it was right when you sold your business, and sometimes I feel like you don't want to name certain people, but
yeah,
he said to you, and in the moment, I think I started to cry, but he said to you, something like, now you can be selective about what you want to do. And I was like, oh, that's what I want so badly. I want to be able to be selective about what I want to do. I don't want to have to do something for money. I don't want to owe somebody. I don't want to have to do something because I feel like I owe them. I want to do good work, and I want to do it in an uncompromised way with integrity. And I want to, you know, I want to do all these things. And that's what I wanted so badly. So I remember that moment, that moment just stuck in my head when he said that. I was like, oh, that's what I want. I just want to be able to, you know, move forward and grow this brand in a way that,
young, and Judge Judy said you could be, you know, any age, 40, 50, 60, and be an entrepreneur. And I didn't become really successful until my late 30s. My book, Business is Personal, is out now, and it's all about this stuff and how the mistakes become successes. This is a big, big fucking mistake. So it's going to be a hole to dig out. But because you do have a platform, not only about helping people this has happened to, which is important, and going back and backtracking all that happened psychologically and emotionally while you have to do that. You don't have the luxury of just doing that. You have to get a plan, get on the road and start. It will be empowering the minute you get the momentum of starting to make money, and this debt will you'll get unleashed. So that has to be a major shift. Like, I know that you're thinking about it and it's plaguing you, but it's like, it's plaguing you. You need to be tackling it. Like, it needs to be your bitch now. That debt is, you're the bitch of that debt now. And you need to make that debt your bitch. That's the difference. Yes, about the 50% about what's happened and your mother and the emotions and survivors and all of that's great. But this debt, you need to make your bitch is all I'm saying. Like, starting now. I've never been like this on this podcast to anyone. So I know that it's right because I can't stop saying it. So I'm going to stop saying it. But I'm just telling you, you need to become a badass now. You're a victim and you need to become a badass. You were a victim. So that's just, I don't want you to throw this advice away. I'm not going to say that again because I don't think you should. So anyway, Alec Baldwin came up in this whole thing, which is funny. And he's been through his own shit storm. Has he surfaced in any of this, or did he have any reaction to any of this? Or is he just an anecdotal piece of this?
Well, we have spoken, and I think that, you know, like everybody on the other side of it, he was probably, you know, like, what the hell happened? And embarrassingly, I think I mentioned earlier when I got out on bail and I got back into my email, because I had been, you know, Mr. Fox had controlled my email that year that we were away. And I didn't have the password. So I had to like jump through hoops with Google to like get back into my old email. Mm-hmm. And when I got in there, I saw that he deleted all of our correspondence between me and him. And then there was this moment where I was like, huh. And then I clicked into the sent folder. And that, more than any other moment, I think that's when I wanted the meteor to hit me and die. Like, I just was like, oh my God. Oh my God. I was reading these emails that he sent to people as me, wanting to just die. And so Alec was one of those people that he'd written to. You know, he also wrote to my little brother. He wrote back to people in my family. He wrote back to,
oh my God.
He was like begging people for money as me. And I'm like,
did he ask
my
Alec
God.
Baldwin for money?
Oh yeah. And in one of Alec's replies, he says something that's the equivalent of like, you don't sound like you, you know, like what? Like he, so, but the thing is, nobody really thinks like,
no,
if you can, you know,
someone's
somebody,
taken over.
Think,
no,
right. Yeah. That doesn't occur to you. No. So, and I think that, and that's why when it was like, I couldn't, to me, I felt like kind of, I feel so stupid, like trying to reach out to people and saying that wasn't me. But if anybody, if I could like open up my, that email and show people like, here's all the emails. And if you see them all together, because in some cases people would say to me, okay, well, you need to call me and we'll talk about it. And then that thread would drop. And then they'd be like, I don't understand why can't you call me? You know, so, and then there were emails there to Jeffrey Chattero. And that was just like, that just made me feel so sick to my stomach.
And do these people say anything now? Like, have they, because this is a little bit of vindication, at least they got those emails. At least you have a little bit of vindication. Have you spoken to Jeffrey or Alec? I've met Alec. I know Jeffrey. You have?
Yeah, I'm on good terms with most everybody. There are some people I haven't spoken to. And again, it's like what you're saying. So, you know, to go back and reach out to some of these people, it's draining, it's mm-hmm. time consuming.
Yes.
And people have said, well, why don't you reach out to this person? And it's like, well, if I did that, that's all I'm doing. I want to focus on moving forward because I want to importantly repay all this. I want to get out and I want to I'd rather focus on repaying, you know,
actions
whatever.
Actions speak louder than words. You'd rather just do it. You don't need to talk.
Right.
Then
like spending like an entire day with just, you know, emotionally draining hours talking to somebody who may or may not understand. And so I'm sort of, you know, for any of those out there who have not heard from me, who might be wondering like, why the hell hasn't she reached out? It's like, I want to, and then I'll, but like, I just want to find a way to repay everybody. I just want to get the money back and repay. Like, I'd rather reach out and go, hey, you know, what are your wiring instructions? Because I want to give you some money back. And by the way, let's talk about what happened. You know, I'd rather be in a position of being able to repay them and then talk about it.
I said,
because it's so draining.
Yeah, I get it. I mean, you know, how people say in AA, like you have to apologize to everybody, and you could do that, I guess, in your own way. But I would agree that it's more important for the actions to happen, which is good. And mm-hmm. then I guess, I don't know. I mean, I first of all, I thank you for talking to me. I know I have an aggressive personality, so by no means do I want you to think that I was like coming at you or I have some angle or I thought it was something. I literally just wanted to talk to you about it because I just felt like I was gravitating towards the topic and the situation. And it's a mixed bag of craziness. And I just thought that, I don't know, people could learn from it, that we could just have an honest conversation. So I really am grateful.
And I think the other part of it that's useful in talking
about
it is
that, sorry,
is that it can, like it can help people recognize if it might be happening to their sister or their friend. Yes. And so it's like the more people understand this type of a thing and the more people understand like sociopathy and what that means and that it's a thing. And I hope that people start to understand it better. But then I hope it doesn't become one of those overused terms the way that like people kind of overuse gaslighting now.
Oh, I know what you're saying. Well, by the way, it's important. Like, yes. And you've talked about, well, I've experienced psychological and verbal mm-hmm. abuse and emotional abuse. And it is, they say it's more harmful than physical abuse. And I have to say, it's traumatizing and it stays in your body for a long time. And you have like a shock reflex to things that aren't normal to have a shock reflex to. I have been called every ugly name in the world. I have been told I'm garbage. I have been told things that I believed and thought like, this is crazy, or just reacted in a way because someone was so controlling. So mm-hmm. I understand how someone can really fuck with you. If someone's entire life, if their goal is to fuck with you, they can do a lot.
If they're good at it, they can do it. And I've heard from women I heard from one woman who said she has a PhD in clinical psychology and she was manipulated to the extent that she didn't know which way was up. I've heard from people who, you know, are powerful attorneys who've been manipulated. I mean, just it happens to a lot of, you know, intelligent and strong women. So
happens a lot to women when they're the more power, the power figure or the moneyed spouse.
Well,
because a man wants to get the control.
Well, right. And for people who do this, it's like what they're getting out of it is taking you down. You know, so the more successful you are, the more you've accomplished, the more they want to destroy you, because that's the goal of it. The goal wasn't for him to take money from me, because then he would have taken it and hopped on a plane to Mexico, and nobody would have bothered to go after him because who cares? But that wasn't his goal. His goal was, it appears, the only thing that makes sense was to not only destroy me, but in a way that, like, to burn all the bridges and to make it maximally hard for me to turn around and make a comeback. So
I've had the same, you know, I've been threatened, I'm going to ruin your life and ruin your career. Yep. Like I've literally, and worked really hard to do that. And when one and it's hard to describe that to other people because this one person has a goal, and you're, if they have a, anybody can, it's really amazing. A small gnat buzzing in your ear constantly could drive you insane, yep. could destroy your life. Like, so it's, and it takes a strong constitution to overcome that and to battle that and beat that down, which I have done. But I really do. I do understand firsthand what stalking, harassment, being emotionally abused is like. And I haven't been that vocal about it specifically for many reasons, but I really understand it. And that probably mm-hmm. is also why this was something that attracted me to talk about with you. So mm-hmm. the Netflix piece. So you feel that it wasn't, that it was not fairly portrayed, or that there were like little cute nuances that are manipulative to the audience, and you've had to like stand up and clarify things because it's just frustrating. It seems like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, and for anyone who's interested, I wrote a long, detailed, like point by point. Here, and I haven't even rewatched it. So I think once I kind of get the strength to sit down and rewatch it, I'll probably see a lot of other things. But it's not that I'm, you know, I figured, of course, it's a crazy story that I didn't even understand, especially when I did those interviews, because it was kind of early on. So I figured, you know, sure, certainly they'll get some things wrong, but I didn't think it would be intentional. And I think it's very clear from the things that were certain editorial choices that were made that it was deliberate. And so that's what I wrote about on my website, kind of point by point. And
which ones and, really matter? Because I got the gist of the whole story. I think you're very in it. And so I want to hear what really, really matters.
The big one is the call at the end, because I think, you know, you said that you understood it to be sort of a something that the director did, or you understood that it was sort of there for some reason, but you didn't see it the way some other people came away with it, which seems weird, but a lot of people came away with it like as if I was in on it, whatever that means, all along or something.
Because it sounded awkward. It sounded like a weird reenactment phone call. It sounded strained. It sounded like someone said, call him, and you guys were talking and it was weird. Like, that's what it sounded like.
It was recorded for the film. So, you know, it's not like I was.
Yeah, it did not sound, but I don't think that, I mean, maybe everyone could find an ant at a picnic, but I mean, I could watch it again. It did not sound like you guys were in cahoots. It sounded a little bit like either what I just said, or this guy's such a sicko that he still has some sort of hold on him that you still, you know, when you talk to him, you still have a weird feeling that you can't control. I don't mean that you're in love with him, but like, and that like Pavlovian almost. That's the two options that I had in my mind watching it. Not that like you guys were bandits ripping everybody off and they have the money like in Switzerland somewhere.
Yeah. Well, a lot of people unfortunately thought that, but, you know, it did sound like I was very friendly with him, but the, you know, it was like I was playing a role, and it was deliberate because I was trying to get him to talk about things. And it was probably like a 40-minute phone call. And so they just played this little part of it where, you know, I'm deliberately and strategically, you know, having a conversation with him, knowing that I'm talking to a
was a little weird, but not
to get. Yes. So the reason I'm kind of laughing and casual with him and sort of is like, I'm doing that deliberately. And that was, you know, I don't know if that was the beginning. I don't know. I didn't go back to the call to listen to see specifically.
I get that. I get where you're coming from, because it seemed like you were a little chubby and it was awkward, but I don't think like I would not like, I would check that box of Netflix as being just like a production thing and being a little cute in editing, but not like crazy. What else did they do that was egregious?
I mean, sort of, but all of it combined. So there are a lot of things before that would allow somebody to think that I might've been in on it. So, you know, one part is there's a part where I start to talk about it's almost like implied sexual abuse, but it cuts off where I think in the film I say something about how he would make me drink wine and then like, you know, do things, and then it ends there. And I know that that, you know, somebody who was there and saw the footage said, like, oh my God, that footage is so compelling. And I was sort of, you know, when I first saw the film, I was shocked because I was sure that that was going to be in it because I was told it was incredibly compelling. And part of me, like my initial reaction was like, the part of me was relieved because of course, you know, it would have been embarrassing and I would be like ugly crying on, you know, and all of that footage where I talk more in detail about that part of what he did was left out of the film. And I think that had it been included, then nobody would have been confused at the end. And so there were like things like that, that had they been done differently, people wouldn't have been, people would have come away with this sort of controversial, because I think all of that stuff was done to create this controversy. Like, did she do it? Did she not do it?
I understand.
Right. And so, and also like it made it.
But the truth is they don't know. They don't know. I'm playing devil's advocate. I'm not like, I don't work for Netflix.
No, they do know. Oh. And it wasn't, it was Chris Smith, the director, more than, because the movie was made and then sold to Netflix.
Got it.
So, and Netflix, their marketing was really, really, really grotesque. And again, it's like what I said before, like, I feel angry and I feel on behalf of other people who've been psychologically abused, because I feel like, you know, they sort of made fun of the whole thing.
Oh, you feel like you went back into another bad relationship with them in the way it was portrayed. Like you just wanted your story to be told in a certain way. Well, anyway, I understand where you're coming from. I appreciate, you know, you coming on here. It's not easy to keep reliving. And I just wanted to get some perspective and I appreciate it. And I really wish you the best of luck. I wish you success and freedom and a good relationship with your family about this, and just to be able to move forward while you're still young and healthy and have your whole life ahead of you.
Yeah. I feel, regardless of what happened, I do feel lucky that, you know, I have a home, I'm healthy, I have my dog, you know, lots of things are fine. And, you know, I'm not there, you know, whatever's happening, it's like, I can handle internet trolls, you know. Right. And also, you know, like I'm safe. I'm fine. Everything's good. You know, I have a home. I have food. I'm not like in a war zone and whatnot. So I do feel grateful. And I feel grateful that I have a platform and opportunities. You know, I know I have all these opportunities.
You do.
I know that a lot of women that are devastated in these types of situations, like don't have any of that. And they have, you know, they might have children involved, which makes it just exponentially more tragic. So I feel
you have a voice.
I do feel lucky and optimistic. I've always been optimistic. So
I like that. And I love your, I would literally pay a lot of money for those cashews right now. Those raw, spicy, sweet cashews you would.
Oh, that's fine. Everybody has their favorites. Yeah. I know people are always throwing out so many different things, but yeah.
And frozen ice creams. I miss all that. So maybe you'll do that again. Cause that is very current now. Too. That's very current. That's would be way more lucrative now than even then. It's very current. So, well, I appreciate you and I hope you have a great day.
Thank you.
I can't wait to hear what happens next.
All right. Thank you so much.
Awesome. Have a great day. Wow. So that was an interesting interview. I honestly, it brought up so much for me to talk to Sarma because of that. I know some of the people involved. So it just was something that I was shocked to find on television, that I've experienced some of the things that she's gone through. So that was thought-provoking, that I'm a business person and that being in debt would just cripple me and it would be just be the only thing I focused on. And I wanted to talk to her just to get an understanding. I didn't even know what I wanted to know. I just was intrigued by this whole topic and I didn't want to badger her, you know, because I don't do that. I don't want to have someone on here so I can just be the superior person and the authority on anything because I'm not. I just wanted to talk to her on behalf of you and the employees and, you know, you're running a restaurant and you leave a restaurant for 9 months. You can't leave a business for 9 days without like a very serious plan. Literally 9 days. I can't just leave my business for 9 days and have the things run smoothly. Like absolute fact. So a restaurant where it's a raw restaurant, back in a time when that wasn't even a current thing and people's paychecks and payroll and running a business and taxes and crazy things like that. Like there's no way that Jeffrey Chodoro can run someone else's business, even if he's the investor. That was the craziest part to me. I just had to understand as a business owner, like you can't walk away from a restaurant for 9 months. It must have been a circus in there. I just wish I paid more attention back then. But anyway, she was in some sort of a trance, and I never questioned someone's emotional experience and abuse experience. I just wanted to get to the bottom of this whole crazy labyrinth and web that was woven. And she's got work to do. It's time to get to work. It's great that you're communicating. It's great that you're talking to survivors. It's great that you're getting the message out. It's great that you're helping future victims. You got to help former victims too. So let's get out there, make some money, and pay off our debts. That was interesting. And I am grateful to her for coming on, because it's not easy to come on and talk when you are a heated person who's been part of a massive scandal. So I give her credit for that.